I'm Richi Bhatia, and on behalf of the Guild Art Gallery and National Gallery of Modern Art, Mumbai, I would like to welcome you all and our speakers for the evening. Thank you for joining us on this very special evening to celebrate the art of Sudhir Patwardhan, one of the great artists of our times. We at Guild are greatly honored to have the privilege of presenting and supporting this retrospective curated by Nancy Adajania. I'm honored to introduce Nancy, a cultural theorist and an independent curator based in Bombay. Adajania was the joint artistic director of the 9th Guangzhou Biennale in 2012 and has curated many exhibitions including Counter Canon, Counter Culture, Alternative Histories of Indian Art for Serendipity Arts Festival 2019. The Earth's Heart Toneout, Navjot Altaf, A Life in Art at National Gallery of Modern Art, Mumbai, 2018 and 19, in collaboration with the Guild Art Gallery. Adajania has taught the curatorial practice course at the Salzburg International Summer Academy of Fine Arts in 2013 and 14. She was the juror for Video, Film, New Media Fellowship Cycle of the Academic Scholars Solitude from 2015 to 2017. Adajania has proposed several new theoretical models through her extensive writing on media art, public art, transcultural art, and the Biennale culture from the Global South. She has lectured on these subjects on numerous venues, including Documenta 11 Castle, ZKM Karlsruhe, the Center for Curatorial Studies, Bard College, New York, and the third former West Research Congress, Vienna. She has recently edited two transdisciplinary anthologies, Some Things That Only Art Can Do, a Lexicon of Effective Knowledge, and Totems and Taboo, What Can and Cannot Be Done for the Raza Foundation 2017 and 18. I would like to invite Ms. Adajania to invite our speakers and take the evening ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Richi. It's wonderful to be back at the NGMA. In fact, I was telling Sudhir in the afternoon that it feels like homecoming because I set up the show, and after the opening, I left for Goa to install yet another show called Counter Canon, Counter Culture, Alternative Histories of Indian Art at the Serendipity Arts Festival. And I just received a message saying that actually the show has been extended. So for people who will be in Goa, do catch the show. It's on till January 15th. But now to return back to the Sudhir Patwardhan retrospective, I'd like to reiterate that I'm deeply honored to curate this long arc of Sudhir's career, 5 decades long, in fact. And putting up this show was a pleasurable experience. It was also an experience of mutual learning. I remember Sudhir saying that, you know, when he looked at the kinds of constellations that I was producing between his artworks, he also found that there were new ways in which his works could be read. And of course, my conversations with Sudhir, especially on the art and the public sphere, and also deep readings of his paintings, led me to many new insights. So I think that these conversations have been mutually productive and fruitful for both of us. I would also like to actually emphasize one more thing, which is both Sudhir and my commitment to multilinguality. So for example, my essay, Walking Through Soul City, Ek Sair Ruh Ke Sheher Mein, has been translated into Marathi by Nupur Desai. And there was also a panel discussion in Marathi, which Sudhir Patwardhan chaired. And unfortunately, I wasn't present at that time because I was putting up my show in Goa, where we had almost around 300 people, I believe. That's what Sudhir told me. And that's extremely gratifying. And we are also going to have a multilingual poetry reading, which will be moderated by Ranjit Hoskote, and which will have poets like Sampurna Chatterjee, Mustansir Dalvi, and others in February. So I think that for both of us, Sudhir and me, we are committed to producing a multilingual public sphere in the context of the arts. Especially because in the art world we are extremely monolingual and Anglophone centric. So with these thoughts in mind, I'd like to now basically start this panel discussion, which we have titled "Close Reading." And in this close reading, each one of us, Gieve Patel, Ranjit Hoskote and I will take one painting of Sudhir's, and then we shall read it through its deep structures, and hopefully we'll be able to come up with insights that you know perhaps have never been put into writing before. The work that I have chosen for my close reading is called Nagrik. It's a work that actually Sudhir started painting in the run-up to the retrospective. And I saw it in his house in Thane, and I was completely fascinated by the work. And also, when I first saw it, there was a great sense of anticipation about, you know, where is Sudhir's practice going, especially just before the retrospective. You know, this is a time of not just retrospecting, but also introspecting. Here is an artist who's looking back at 5 decades of his life and his work. And so more on Nagrik. But before that, I'd also like to connect Nagrik to what's happening right now in the last week in Bombay, as well as in other parts of our country. Nagrik, as we all know, means citizen. Citizenship has become a contentious category in the last few days. It has been weaponized to exclude people on the basis of their religion. Thousands of people poured into the August Kranti Maidan 2 days ago to express their solidarity against the Citizenship Amendment Act, or CAA, which paves the way for a sectarian basis of who can qualify for Indian citizenship. Last night, even as lawyers gear out the police station at Daryaganj in Delhi, demanding the release of detainees protesting against CAA, some of whom were minors, Mamata Banerjee's chant, "Amra Kara, who are we, citizens? Amra Shobai, Nagorik." We are all citizens, irrespective of the religion that we belong to, whether we are Hindus, Muslims, or Christians. And this chant, "Amra Shobai, Nagorik," is something that was resonating in my ears while I was preparing for this panel discussion. "Amra Shobai Nagorik," we are all citizens, is also a chant that resonates through Sudhir Patwardhan's 5-decade-long retrospective. Sudhir's works speak to people across class, religious, and caste identities, as well as constituencies. At the opening, NGMA was brimming with people from all walks of life. It felt like one big art community, even if just for an evening. The South Bombay collector was rubbing shoulders with the Marathi poet from North Bombay. The capitalist concentrating on accident on May Day was standing alongside the grassroots activist talking about the then unfolding political fiasco in Maharashtra. Let us concentrate on Nagorik, the painting here. In it, 4 figures levitate above a cityscape, not like Banksy's free-spirited balloons, but like colossi, rising from, yet claimed by, an Escheresque patchwork of buildings that alternately recedes from and advances towards us. It is not unusual to encounter ordinary citizens fashioned as monumental beings in Patwardhan's paintings. Next slide, please. This was Mamata Banerjee at the rally. Next slide, please. "Running Woman," 1977. One such monumental painting is "Running Woman," 1977, which was inspired by the larger-than-life figures in Mexican murals, and it offered a testimony to the resilience of the working woman. But what we encounter in "Back to Nagorik," But what we encounter in Nagrik here is more than a simple valorization of the subaltern body. These figures who float above rooftops have released themselves, however momentarily, from the hegemony of social structures. At first glance, these Nagriks or citizens seem to have much in common with Binod Bihari Mukherjee's medieval artisan saints. Next slide, please. And these artisan saints commingle with ordinary people in a riverine procession of everyday life. And this mural is actually by Binod Bihari Mukherjee, as I said, and this is his Hindi Bhavan mural, which was painted in 1947. It is a work that Patwardhan loves. Next slide, please. However, there are important differences between the two tableaux. The Hindi Bhavan mural is premised on layer, a continuous pulsing rhythm that propels its figures onward in time, place, and diurnal activity. Nagrik measures the ascension of its colossi against a ground note of Thairav, stillness. The scenes of domesticity to which its protagonists remain moored are vespertine or nocturnal, with figures at rest, asleep, or dreaming. Back to Nagrik, please. Thank you. If you look on the extreme left top corner, you have a windswept tree, and there's a sleeping figure on the veranda. And this is actually a memory residue from the time the artist spent in Shantiniketan. The rest of the interiors do not specifically quote locations in either Bombay, Thane, or Pune. Rather, they are symbolic of, can we just go back to the same slide? Rather, they are symbolic of what Sudhir Patwardhan calls a nagar, the ever-evolving city. Nagrik, as we know, is derived from nagar. As we move through an Escheresque cityscape that puzzles us with its mismatched planes and perspectives, we zoom into a house with a hypnotic whirring fan and zoom out of a somnolent bungalow. We become witnesses to a nagar experiencing a slow transition from buildings with Mangalore roof tiles to factory sheds to glass towers. On the right-hand side of the painting, a ship loaded with houses yearns for a harbor, even as the reflection of a woman reading in her living room is spun upside down in the lower corner of the painting here, right there, extreme right. In the middle of this uncanny tableau of micro transitions caught in the twilight zone between stillness and kinesis, one of the Nagriks, with one hand on his heart in a rhetorical gesture, manifests his resplendent diamond-faceted thoughts. They emanate from his head as a continuous unfolding of platonic solids, signals from an altered consciousness, signifiers of perfection and an ideal world. They camouflage themselves into the rooftops. Next slide, please. In recent years, Sudhir Patwardhan has punctuated his realistic paintings with impossible objects, pure mathematical forms that do not have a three-dimensional reality and can be visualized only as optical illusions. The Penrose Triangle in Enigma, made in 2017, is one such mathematical conundrum that provokes the viewer to ask, which is the model and which is the reality? Patwardhan pushes the question of representation to the extreme through these impossible objects, questioning and critically expanding his commitment to realism, based both on a sensate experience and the life, as well as the life of the mind. In the manner of Escher, he perplexes his viewers through an optical sleight of hand, turning recessed and advancing planes inside out. Back to Nagrik, please. To return to Nagrik, when we look at that man with these diamond faceted thoughts at the extreme right of the painting, we would ask ourselves the question, does the seamless merging of the diamond faceted thoughts with reality lead to an easy correlation between the everyday and the miraculous? Or is the artist telling us that this is an uneasily achieved transcendence by four citizens who have not yet given up their nagrikhood or their citizenhood, their right to demand political freedom. Look at their bare feet, seemingly free of gravity, yet trying to find purchase on a tiled roof or the slippery glass walls of a skyscraper. It is interesting to note that Sudhir had earlier called the painting Four Dwellers, but he was unhappy with the title and promptly renamed it Nagrik, which goes to show that although Sudhir may have moved towards the representation of his own family and towards channeling personal memories over historical causes since the 2000s, he has not moved towards a civil privatism. I borrow the term civil privatism from Habermas. By civil privatism, he means a moving away from the public sphere and withdrawing into a zone of family relationships and leisure. So Sudhir does not withdraw into a zone of family relationships and leisure, although he starts channeling his personal memories. And what Sudhir is doing here is that he's able to take a more reflective stance in these new works. He's neither reactive, he's in the way he addresses the subjects of his paintings, he's not just moving from one political crisis to another, nor has he withdrawn into an interiority that is hermetically sealed. The diamond-faceted thoughts constituting Platonic solids, which signal the crafting of a new consciousness, also draw attention to a fresh phase in Sudhir's work, which I would argue is propelled by a constant interplay between a palpable materialism and a philosophical idealism. As a coda to this presentation, I would like to invoke another artist, a filmmaker who has passionately dealt with the question of nagrikhood or citizenship. Ritwik Ghatak, whose films were veined with the experiences of loss and unbelonging, was himself a victim of the partition. He never wanted Bengal to be partitioned, and he always longed for the unification of Bengal. And his films are saturated with the poetics of loss. And in fact, next slide, please. This is a poster for Nagrik. In fact, he made a film called Nagrik. That was his first film. And most people don't know about this film because it was actually released. It was made in the early 50s, even before Pather Panchali was made. And therefore, some critics have argued that actually one of the first art house films in Bengal was not Pather Panchali, but actually Nagrik. It's just that Nagrik was not released during his lifetime. It was released after his death, so almost like 24, 25 years. So it was released in 77. And that's why people never really got to see it. But I believe Satyajit Ray knew about Nagrik and perhaps may even have seen it. And Nagrik, which was made, as I said, in early 1950s, again talks about the pain of partition. It talks about a family which has been uprooted, and it talks about the growing unemployment that the son of the house has to face. It talks about the kind of trauma that the women in the family face. The sister can't get married because they have become very poor. They move from a huge haveli or a mansion to this little hovel in the slums. So the film is about this tragedy unfolding of a particular family, but in a way it also speaks about the kind of loss that was actually experienced by people due to the partition. And Nagrik, of course, is much more didactic, pedantic, and then slowly he's able to craft a poetics which is completely his own, which in a way, as Kumar Shani would have said, it deals with the epic reality, but also it is veined with melodrama. And next slide, please. When Ghatak made Nagrik, it was influenced by his experiences in IPTA, the Indian People's Theatre Association, which was the cultural wing of the CPI, the Communist Party of India. And although in Nagrik, Ghatak does not speak specifically about IPTA, in Komal Gandhar, the film which was made in 1961, he actually talks about the authoritarianism in the leftist parties. He talks about the kind of Stalinist moves whereby artists could be thrown out of the party. And in fact, what happened with Ghatak was that in 1954, he actually came to know that the people in the bigwigs in the party wanted him out of the party, and his name was mud in the communist circles. And the reason for this was because he had written a paper, a thesis for the CPI called On the Cultural Front, where he talks about how culture should not just be treated as a superstructure. It's something that should be treated as something that's integral to the leftist politics. And he also spoke about how the artist is somebody who should not just be treated as a mobilizer, who has to mobilize people for a political cause. He believed that through their art, the artist could actually mobilize thousands of people, and that they should be given the freedom to do so, and not just be propagandists. That they could also produce art which could be full of ambiguities, and which was not merely reiterating whatever the party command was asking them to do. And because of this subversive document, he was thrown out of the party. And now you might just ask, hey Nancy, what has that got to do with Sudhir Patwardhan? Well, it has a lot to do with Sudhir Patwardhan, because in fact Sudhir also has a similar trajectory much later in the 70s. He's at the medical college in Pune, and he starts going for art classes in the evening, which were hobby classes to begin with, and then he decides to take art very seriously. And this is also the time in the early 70s when he socialized into Marxist thought and the question of dialectical materialism. So Sudhir's trajectory is also quite similar. He's been socialized in leftist thought, and then he begins to critically understand what communism is, what leftist thought is, how does an artist produce work which can actually change the consciousness of the people, but at the same time he's not merely just basically making tokenistic gestures towards a political cause. So next slide, please. So I thought of ending with street play, because I also wanted to show, just as I have actually shown how Ghatak, he was socialized in the leftist party. He wrote plays for IPTA. He also acted in IPTA, in fact. And then he slowly started critically questioning the role of the artist in leftist politics. So here you have Sudhir Patwardhan, socialized in leftist thought in the early 70s, and by early 1980s in street play, you already have him also taking a critical stand. So here you have this very complex painting, which is sort of stitched seamlessly across locations. You have the arcades of DN Road, and then you have the mill lands. And this was done, of course, before Photoshop actually comes into existence. So he was seamlessly stitching together different locations even before digital media takes on. So here you have him, the artist as a witness, seemingly standing inside a pillar and witnessing a street play. And of course, witnessing the violence that he witnessing the violence that is actually occurring on the street, and of course, one of the actors in the street play, his hands are spread eagled, almost like he's actually been crucified. And you also have, what you can't see in this slide, but within the arcades on the wall, you also have a faint you just have the faint presence of a cross. So again, these particular resonances of crucification, of being martyred for a cause, are very much present in this work. And I also wanted to show street play because I wanted to show how already by the early 80s, Sudhir is looking at leftist politics from a critical eye, without of course giving up the belief in equality, but also thinking about the position of the artist. And And later on, of course, because he always had this discomfort with the fact that art is only shown in the hallowed precincts of a gallery, he moves out of the gallery. He also shows his works in Pokhran, which was a neighborhood outside of Thane. He also then produces an exhibition on modern contemporary art and travels it through different parts of the hinterlands of Maharashtra. So I just wanted to talk about both Ghatak and Sudhir Patwardhan to in a way also expand our field of inquiry. And with that, now I would like to invite Gieve Patel and Ranjit Hoskote, both of you on the stage. Gieve will now present a close reading of one of the paintings that he feels very close to. Please come on stage. And and Gieve has been a soulmate as well as a devil's advocate of Sudhir Patwardhan. They both met because actually it was Ganeshwar Narkani who said that, you know, the two of them should meet. And I think that Narkani was right. And that's why we have two of the country's best artists here together with us on this dais. Thank you so much.